Good afternoon. I'm Spot On Weather meteorologist Matthew Euler. Welcome to today's video, and this one's titled Reviving Winter. This was me the other day, just trying to do my best to revive winter across the mid-Atlantic. You see I'm administering CPR to the snowman over here in the left-hand picture, and in the right-hand picture here, checking for any kind of breathing. I didn't check the pulse at all, but, compressions and then listening for some breathing, whether it's through the carrot nose here or the mouth of the snowman. But anyway, yeah, I'm kind of going to desperate measures here, ain't I? If you like winter, like I do, it's, just recently since that major cold wave that we had back in late December, it's been fairly mild across the mid-Atlantic and the Eastern U.S. as a whole. I've got a lot to cover in today's video, so let's go ahead and get started. First thing I want to start off with is, what does January 2023, what does this month of January look so far as temperature anomalies? As you can see by the brown coloring there on the graphic here provided by PRISM, the PRISM Climate Group at Oregon State University, you'll notice how much above normal we're talking here in the Eastern U.S., anywhere from Texas all the way up to New England, mid-Atlantic areas, even the Ohio Valley. We're talking about temperatures so far, the mean temperature, average temperature between January 1st and January 8th, on the order of 10 to 15 degrees Fahrenheit above normal in the brown areas here. We do see a little bit of cooler weather out west there over portions of the higher elevations of Sierra Nevadas of California. But, they've been getting hit with so much rain out here. And even out here in the west, it's not really a very cool pattern, as Pacific air has pretty much dominated from west coast to east coast, if you notice this. So again, getting off to a very mild start so far in the month of January 2023. Before I begin talking about the various atmospheric processes in today's forecast graphics, I want to do a quick overview of the difference between short waves in the atmosphere versus long waves in the atmosphere. All right, so here's an example of, these solid black lines were lines of equal height. Each one of these lines represents lines of equal height. These are known as height contours and upper level charts. And then this maroon or red dashed line is indicating where that trough axis is occurring and how it dips down. You see how these black solid lines, these height contours kind of dip down? This indicates the area of lowest heights on an upper air chart. And so we have these little short waves that occur. You notice how the amplitude, or rather the wavelength of this wave, is not really, it's much less as compared to, say, over here. Notice how much larger this wavelength is for the long wave over here on the right. And so we have these little short waves that rotate through this long wave pattern. These short waves are responsible really for initiating and kicking off the storm systems that we experience here on the Earth's surface. And so you see these little short waves, they tend to superimpose themselves over the long wave pattern. For the long waves, I want you to think with long waves, with these longer wavelengths, think about the jet stream as an example of a longer wave situation in the atmosphere. Short waves will be associated with those upper air disturbances at 500 millibars or 700 millibars that can initiate surface low pressure development out ahead of the shortwave trough axis. I'm going to get into the vorticity aspect here in a minute. So we have short waves, we have long waves, and we have these short waves that are kind of moving through the long wave pattern. Occasionally they deepen this pattern, the troughing pattern in the long waves. And then we have something very important that's known as vorticity. Vorticity is simply the spin of an air parcel about an axis. And the big things about vorticity, short waves vorticity, they tie into vertical motion, vertical lifting mechanisms in the atmosphere. So, for example, whenever we have the height contours, these solid dark lines indicating more of a U-shaped pattern, out ahead of this shortwave trough axis, if I were to draw the axis right down the center here, the lowest dipping point here, we'd have an area of positive vorticity advection occurring ahead of the shortwave trough axis. Now, why is PVA, or positive vorticity advection, so important in the upper atmosphere? Because it generally tends to give us rising vertical air motion. And that rising vertical air motion, as air rises, it cools, it condenses, it forms clouds whenever you get rising vertical air motion. And a lot of times you get some sort of precipitation as a result that comes from the clouds back down to the ground, back to the surface. So positive vorticity advection typically occur ahead of the shortwave trough axes. And then out ahead of shortwave ridge axes, you get what's known as NVA, or negative vorticity advection. Now, with negative vorticity advection, it's just the opposite of PVA. NVA is associated with sinking air motion, clear skies, and nice weather. PVA is associated with rising air motion, clouds, and precipitation. This is typically the area downstream of the shortwave trough axis associated with the PVA that you're going to get storm development to occur. So I just wanted to kind of cover a review and why we look at specific charts in the atmosphere and why they really matter in our sensible weather here at the Earth's surface. Let's go ahead and take a look at the charts now. So right now, we're watching a storm for late this week. This is the 500 millibar forecast. The 500 millibar forecast is at an altitude or elevation of about 18,000 feet above the ground. We're looking at 500 millibars, so we are examining these specific short waves in the atmosphere, whether we're talking about shortwave troughs, as is shown here, or shortwave ridges, okay? Whenever you see the orange coloring, think shortwave ridge. Whenever you see the greens and the purple coloring, think shortwave troughs. All right, so this is the forecast for this upcoming Saturday morning, the 14th of January. I have the GFS ensemble forecast on the left, and this is the European ensemble forecast on the right. Overall, pretty good agreement with the placement of these shortwave features, whether we're talking about a shortwave ridge, generally located over the central U.S. or the northern plains and the south central Canada, or we're looking at this deep shortwave trough, okay, right off the southeast coast. We have upstream ridging occurring, higher heights associated with a ridge. We typically would get sinking air out ahead of that ridge axis over parts of the upper Midwest, Minnesota, and Iowa. And then downstream of that, we're going to have that shortwave trough. And ahead of the shortwave trough axis, we're going to get that rising air motion, that positive vorticity advection, or PVA, ahead of the trough axis. I'm going to look and we'll look and examine those vorticity charts here in a moment. But just around, I want to show you that we're definitely getting higher confidence there's going to be a storm of some sort by late this week, particularly Friday the 13th, potentially lasting impacts lasting into Saturday the 14th of January. One major thing I wanted to point out, the differences between the ensembles. Now, this is a 00Z model run for the European. I'm still waiting on the data to come in for the 12Z, the midday run today. But as of this morning, the European model was much more deeper. See the purple coloring much darker here? This graphic on the right with the European ensemble showing a more intense or a greater area of lower than normal heights, stronger system, in other words, on the EPS, European ensemble. Vice over here, it's not as the shortwave trough, it isn't as amplified or deep. Now let's examine some of the midday operational model run today. I've got the GFS, I've got the Canadian operational, as well as a European operational. So let's start here with the GFS model run from today's run. This is the 9th of January, Monday the 9th. I'm showing generally what we have going on now. On the graphic here on the left is a GFS forecast for this Friday morning, the 13th of January at about 07 local standard time for the East Coast, showing a lot of showers extending from Florida, working its way northward into the Carolinas, right on up into Virginia, Maryland, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, New York State, all the way up into far northern portions of New England. Just rain is what the forecast is calling for, with a 991 millibar low situated north of Lake Huron, basically, in the southeastern Canada. So we have a cold front extending all the way down the East Coast this Friday morning, according to the latest GFS model, with a lot of rain all the way up and down Interstate 95 cities and right along the coast. Now, this is the forecast for the early afternoon for this upcoming Friday, the 13th of January. Still showing the rain hanging on, but look how mild it is all the way up to Maine. See the green coloring? That's all rain. It's all rain. Right ahead of this stronger front that's about to come through. And the main area of lower pressure at 997 millibars, it's starting to fill. In other words, it's starting to weaken up here in southeastern Canada. One primary low pressure system, according to the GFS. See this? We have that red L stamped on the model. All right. If this is the case, if GFS is the right model to verify for this upcoming Friday, We are simply just going to see an area, a period of rain basically along the East Coast all the way up to New England. And we'll have colder, drier air filtering in behind that frontal passage. So this is a case a lot of times in the Mid-Atlantic, for example, where we see colder air chasing the moisture or the precipitation. So we're not expecting any kind of, you know, let's say, according to the GFS model anyway, we're not expecting any kind of transition from rain to snow and any significant impacts. Look at the 500 millibar vorticity forecast here for the GFS model for the same time periods. Generally, we're looking Friday afternoon on the left, the 13th of January over here, Friday afternoon, and then on the right, I'm showing you the GFS vorticity forecast for this Saturday morning, the 14th of January. And so what I'm really looking at here is the shapes of these solid black lines. And so I have this upside down U shape in the black lines indicates a ridge, a shortwave ridge extending from New Mexico, Arizona, northward all the way to south central and southwestern Canada, with a downstream trough generally east of the Rockies extending into the southeastern U.S. See all these orange colorings, these brighter orange colorings? That indicates stronger positive vorticity. Your trough axis, your shortwave trough axis for this upcoming Friday afternoon, early afternoon, according to the GFS, is going to be situated from eastern Ohio right on down through parts of eastern Tennessee, western North Carolina, into North Georgia. This is your trough axis. So ahead of that trough axis, we'd expect to find that lifting, right? That positive vorticity advection occurring. The winds are blowing from the southwest at the 500 millibar level. That's going to advect or move or transport more positive or higher values of vorticity towards the Carolinas and Virginia and then all the way up the East Coast. That's why we're seeing that rain, because we have rising air motion associated with that positive vorticity advection. Look at the graphic here on the right. This is for Saturday morning. We're now seeing the brightest oranges offshore over the western Atlantic, off the coast of eastern Massachusetts, right on down to the western Atlantic. And so now the shortwave trough axis is basically right overhead of Hampton Roads, Virginia, down to eastern North Carolina. And once this trough axis passes at 500 millibars, that generally leads to decreasing vorticity values, or what we call negative vorticity advection. And that is going to act to dry the air column out. It's going to result in sinking air motion. That's the opposite of what you want with storms, with any kind of storm system. You want rising air motion, not sinking air motion. Additionally, the tilt of this trough is more positively tilted Saturday morning. It's not neutral, it's not negative. What I mean by that is the trough axis orientates itself from northeast to southwest in a positive tilted manner. This indicates a weaker overall system. Now, let's take a look at the Canadian 12Z midday model run today. And what do we have? We still have that stamp of low pressure, generally 1,000 millibar low there in the vicinity of Lake Huron, working its way towards southeastern Canada. We have a lot of green on the map here. This is for Friday morning, the 13th on the left from the Canadian, showing a lot of green all the way up into Vermont, New Hampshire, New York State, Buffalo, no major snowstorm at this point. Like we've seen that area get clobbered already this winter season with multiple winter storms that just have buried the city. So just rain. Rain Friday morning all the way up the East Coast, all the way to New England, and we're talking 13 January. We got a cold front that's approaching again from the west by Friday morning. And on the right, this is the Canadian operational model forecast. Now notice what's happening here now on the right hand graphic. By Friday early afternoon, we see 1,001 millibar low pressure now showing up along the Virginia, North Carolina border, okay? Let's keep following this area, this new area of low pressure, right? We no longer see the primary low up over southeastern Canada. We now see a new low developing along the frontal boundary, the strong cold front, over parts of the Mid-Atlantic. By late Friday, we have colder air filtering in behind the front. Here's the forecast over here on the left for, this would be Friday evening, the 13th of January. Now that area low pressure is pretty much situated over the Outer Banks or close to that area, northeastern North Carolina, at 998 millibar central pressure. We have a lot of rain going all the way up to Maine, for the Mid-Atlantic to Maine, still 2 miles for any kind of wintry precip. We do see a little bit of a changeover of snow back in the Ohio Valley, higher elevations of West Virginia, for example, parts of eastern Kentucky, Ohio. But in general, we're looking at a rain event, even in the Canadian model. We just have the air's just too mild ahead of this strong cold front. That's where all the moisture is. It's in the warm sector of the cyclone. Looking at the graphic here on the right, we see that trough deepening. The blue dashed lines are dipping further south. That indicates lower thickness values and colder temperatures overall. And we see a 991 millibar low now off Delmarva by Saturday morning, this upcoming Saturday morning, the 14th of January. And now we're starting to see a little bit of rain turn over to snow up towards Northern Virginia into parts of Maryland by Saturday morning, according to the Canadian operational model. Look at the vorticity now for the Canadian model, today's midday operational model, showing, again, that troughing feature very well. Look at the U-shaped pattern to these solid black lines. Look at all the orange colors, those deeper orange colors indicating stronger values of positive vorticity. Here's a scale, by the way, here on the right, showing you how, you know, what the actual numerical value is associated with these colors of positive vorticity. We have more of a neutrally tilted trough axis from Ohio right on down into southern Georgia. So out ahead of this trough axis on Friday afternoon, we would expect to see some lifting occurring across the Mid-Atlantic, eastern Virginia, right on north to New Jersey, and all the way working up towards parts of Long Island, for example. And then here's the graphic here on the right, the forecast for the Canadian vorticity at 500 millibars. Now it's showing a closed off upper level low over basically Hampton Roads area of Virginia by this Saturday morning, the 14th of January. Notice this closed low aloft. Wow. So this system is more intense. We have a neutrally tilted upper level trough axis. And overall, again, a more intense system according to the Canadian model. We have secondary cyclogenesis or development of a cyclone along the frontal boundary further south by really right here, starting Friday afternoon on the Canadian model. We see an area of low pressure, a new area of low pressure takeover over the Mid-Atlantic. Now let's take a look at the 12Z European model run. All right, so initially this is a forecast on the European operational for this Friday morning, the 13th of January. Notice the green coloring here. This is all the heavier precipitation again, the rain working its way in the warmer, milder air ahead of the cold front from coastal South Carolina, North Carolina, coastal Virginia, right on up into Delmarva area. Parts of coastal New Jersey, into Long Island, into Connecticut, Massachusetts, Vermont, New Hampshire, as well as into Maine. This is all, what all the models agree with is Friday morning, it's rain along a strong cold front, generally from Florida all the way up to New England. It's rain. It's just too mild ahead of this strong cold front. Now, the European model is stamped a 997 millibar low, generally in the vicinity of, that'd be Lake Ontario. Looking at the graphic here on the right now, moving forward in time, we see that a new area of low pressure now. The European is showing this now. We have a new area of low pressure just off the coast of North Carolina. This is this will be this Friday afternoon, the 13th of January. We got a lot of moisture streaming ahead of the cold front all the way up into portions of New England. But a lot of the moisture is offshore. You notice where these green colors, these darker green colors are, as well as these lighter orange colors. This is precipitation that is offshore over the Western Atlantic. Okay? So we have two operational models that are now showing the development of a potential secondary area of low pressure along the frontal boundary, developing somewhere either right off the North Carolina coast over the Western Atlantic, or over portions just inland, over portions of eastern North Carolina, southeastern Virginia coming up. Now let's look at the vorticity value. The vorticity value chart here, the overall forecast for it on the European operational run, showing more of a neutrally tilted trough, very similar actually to the Canadian model. Very similar actually, look at this. I'm comparing the Canadian model. This is for Friday afternoon, the 13th of January on the left. And this is the European model for the, this is European, am I doing that wrong? Yeah, so this would be very similar outcome is what I'm getting at with the European model. Yeah, actually that did not update. I apologize for that. So I don't have the 500 millibar vorticity for the European model at this time. I'm gonna have to go back and take a look at that. This is still the Canadian model actually, so that's why it looks so similar to the Canadian model. All right, so bottom line here, minus the vorticity chart here for the European model to see where that positive vorticity is located. In general, we're looking at definitely some rain. The models are in agreement for rain extending right along the East Coast for Friday, this Friday, the 13th of January, in the morning into the afternoon hours, ahead of the strong cold front. They differ, the GFS versus the Canadian operational and the European model. They're all not quite in sync yet, because the Canadian operational wants to develop that low pressure at the surface, a new low along the mid-Atlantic coast, and so does the European model. All right. Now, let's take a look and shift gears here. So we know there's going to be a storm at the end of this week. Let's take a look a little bit into the future now. Let's take a look at the teleconnections forecast. We're going to start with the European Ensemble Arctic Oscillation 50 perturbed member forecast. Now, the green line represents the average or the mean of the model, of all the model members. And so we're seeing more of a negative Arctic oscillation basically all the way out to the 24th of January. See how the green line stays in the negative territory? See the values over here on the left? So a negative Arctic oscillation is expected. Now, what would you expect for the 500 millibar height anomalies during a negative NAO, or rather a negative AO? You'd expect below normal heights, generally from New England right on down into the central U.S. And you would expect above average heights associated with a weaker polar vortex with a negative AO across the high north over the polar areas. Now, let's take a look at the NAO, North Atlantic Oscillation. Generally showing a positive value here coming up 10 to about the 14th of January. Then that NAO is the average, the green line here indicating near average or near neutral conditions from the 14th all the way out to the 24th of January. So neutral condition NAO is the forecast. And then here's just examples here on the right showing you a 500 millibar heights during a positive NAO here on the upper right, showing the orange coloring and yellow coloring indicating above normal heights during a positive NAO right along the East Coast. So a milder East Coast with a positive NAO. And then over here in the bottom right, the purple coloring indicating below normal heights across the Western Atlantic right on down into the East Coast as well as the Deep South. Okay, you get higher than normal heights over portions of Greenland and also points just to the west of Greenland with a negative NAO. We've seen that back in December. Now for the Eastern Pacific Oscillation Forecast, EPO, the European EPS, the European Ensemble, showing a dip to negative briefly for the EPO before going positive, and fairly strongly positive, I might add, basically from 14 January right on up to 20 January before starting to come back down. It's forecast to go back negative after the 23rd of January. Now, why is the EPO so important? We have been seeing a positive EPO for a little bit. And look at what happens when you have a positive EPO. You have a faster or stronger Pacific jet stream. This faster west to east jet stream tends to flood the North American continent with milder Pacific air from the west coast to the east coast. And look at your temperature anomalies here with a positive EPO pattern. Very mild across anywhere east of the Rocky Mountains is just warmer than normal. And we've been seeing this quite a bit lately, at least in the first part of January. The coldest temperatures remain with a positive EPO over Alaska and over parts of the Yukon territories, the far, far northwestern portions of Canada. With a negative EPO, on the other hand, here in the bottom right, we now get the establishment of this Alaskan upper level ridge again. So we get a ridge kind of poking its way north into Alaska with a negative EPO pattern. And then we get downstream troughing, with the coldest temperatures generally going to be over southern Canada into the northern plains and Midwest, with a negative EPO pattern. Sometimes this cold can actually extend all the way to the East Coast. And you also notice with a negative EPO pattern with the upper level ridge extending into Alaska, you generally have warmer than normal temperatures in Alaska itself. Now, finally, let's take a look at the PNA forecast. The European EPS, the European Ensemble, showing the green line here indicating the average of all the ensemble members, showing a dips, you know, basically a positive tendency, a slightly positive tendency to the EPA or to the PNA. And then it's going to dip back to negative, slightly negative from 16 right to 20 January before moving back positive there on 23-24 January. And what's so important about the PNA, Pacific North American pattern, whether it's positive or negative, a positive phase PNA here in the upper right. With a positive phase PNA, you get an upper level ridge into the western portions of Canada up to Alaska, and downstream of that, anomalously highly amplified ridge you get a deep trough, and upper level troughs and below average temperatures focus across the eastern U.S. with a positive PNA. Now with a negative PNA here in the bottom right, we have the reversal pattern. Okay, we have a deep trough across the western U.S. and western Canada, and we have, in response to that deeper trough across the western U.S., we have a ridge that develops up with above average temperatures across the eastern U.S. with a negative PNA. So that's why we pay attention to these teleconnections. Every one of them has a known overlying effect of the atmosphere, the overall circulation pattern, and it impacts us significantly, especially in the winter season. All right, so now let's take a look at the MJO forecast. Today I'm going to show you the forecast from the JEFS V12 as well as a European model on the right here. So the JEFS V12 here on the left showing that the MJO working its way, basically, as we move towards mid-January, it's working its way towards phase one with convection focused in the Western Hemisphere. The blue line then takes over 17 right to 23 January. We notice that the MJO on the JEFS V12 is getting stronger in magnitude, getting further away from the center point in the diagram. And then also look at the European model here on the right, going out through 23 January, showing a pretty much in phase eight, coming up into phase eight, 11 to 15 January, and then MJO rotating to phase one, convection again focused in the Western Hemisphere from 17 to 19 January before rotating into phase two. So you notice phase one and phase two here, right? It's heading that way. Well, let's look at the temperature composites here on the right. And the blue coloring indicates for the months of January, February, and March, these are the temperature composites. Blue coloring indicates below normal temps, and orange coloring indicates above normal temps. So with the MJO forecast to work its way from 8 to 1 to 2, so let's just follow it. 8 is cold in the east, or below normal temps in the east. It's blue coloring. See that? Phase 1 is also below normal temps over, you know, not only the eastern U.S. in phase 1, but also over parts of the western U.S. And then phase 2 is also slightly cooler than normal across the eastern U.S. And then finally, La Niña. La Niña is hanging tough. If you look at the temperature anomalies, the blue coloring indicating below normal temperature departures in this Niño 3.4 region. Here's the latest forecast, the temperature trace, actually, the observation. You know, we were back up just under a minus 1 degree Celsius temperature anomaly in Niño 3.4 region, but now we've dipped back down again. We've dipped back down again as of January 9th, down to minus 1.19 degrees Celsius below normal water temps in that Niño 3.4 region. So La Niña is in the moderate intensity category once again. It keeps fluctuating between low and moderate intensity to higher end weak intensity. This is definitely projected to continue to weaken as we move through January into February, the La Niña itself. And you'll notice now the darkest blues are over the central portions of the equatorial Pacific now too. So, you know, it seems like things are warming right off the coast of South America now, the water temps. And now the coldest temperatures seem to be focused out over the central equatorial Pacific. So something to watch, but I mean, La Niña is still in, it's still hanging in there, folks. Now let's take a look at the longer range forecast. Can we revive winter? Like I started back at the beginning on the beginning slide, trying to administer CPR to the snowman. Is there a way we can bring back winter? Is there any signs that it might return? At least some colder temperatures and maybe lasting a little bit longer in time period. Well, there is hope if you want winter weather in the east. Okay, we do see an upper level ridge that's developing, the pattern's changing. This is the JEFS forecast, GFS ensemble. Forecast here on the graphic on the left here is for the 22nd of January. Forecast graphic here on the right is for the 24th of January, showing those deeper blue colors now across the Midwest on the 22nd, working their way slowly to the East Coast by the 24th. So things are looking colder. We're looking like we're seeing below normal heights now moving into the central U.S., the Midwest, shifting a little bit closer to the East Coast by the 24th of January. One big thing you notice too is this orange coloring out here or along the West Coast of North America from Pacific Northwest right up into Western Canada and even Alaska. You'll notice some rising heights building up here, these orange colors. So you're getting more of a positive PNA in the future, starting around the 22nd of January with a deeper trough downstream, those blue colors indicating below normal heights. Here's the European ensemble prediction system showing a very similar situation. We have ridging occurring along the west coast of North America, with downstream troughing in the blue coloring there from the Midwest all the way over to the East Coast. This is the 22nd of January on the left, and this is a European EPS forecast, upper level heights anomaly forecast for Tuesday, the 24th of January on the right, showing that ridge building up in amplitude a little bit all the way up to Alaska. The ridge axis extends with a downstream trough and potentially lower heights and colder temperatures from the Midwest to the East Coast as we head towards the last, entering the last week of January. So here are the final thoughts on today's video. Precipitation is definitely expected by Friday, the 13th of January, this upcoming Friday. We're going to see a strong cold front moving into the mid-Atlantic. Right now, I feel like it's just going to be a strong cold front with some rain out ahead of the cold front. And then behind that cold front, we'll see colder, drier air move in and giving us quite a chilly weekend. Now, the 12Z Canadian model, the operational model, as I showed you, shows a secondary cyclone developing along the front across the mid-Atlantic by Friday afternoon, evening time period. Overall, the Canadian model shows a more intense solution as compared to GFS, with the potential for rain changing to snow in some portions of the mid-Atlantic. I'm not really buying this yet. I'm waiting, you know, this could change. You know, we're still 96 hours out from this event, 4 days out. So we just have to keep watching the model runs. The 12Z GFS shows a less intense system with precip occurring along the cold frontal passage, conditions drying out behind the front, cold front, by Saturday the 14th of January. And this happens a lot of times here in the mid-Atlantic. You get drier northwest winds to blow in behind the cold frontal passage, and that dry air just pretty much, that northwest wind pretty much just dries out the entire air column. And it's just, you can just get colder with breezy conditions behind cold fronts. Now, also, as far as temperature go, we're going to see a cold upcoming Saturday, the 14th of January, as well as Sunday, 15th January, with high temps generally in the 40s, with lows in the 30s. The pattern is going to become mild yet again, though, next week, from Tuesday, the 17th of January, right through Saturday, the 21st of January. It looks like we're going to return to above normal temps across the eastern U.S. behind the cold front, behind the main storm system and cold front this upcoming Friday into Saturday. We're going to see a colder weekend behind that cold front, but then things get mild again next week. Pattern change is possible, as I showed in the longer range ensembles. After the 21st of January, we're going to see higher heights building across the western portion of North America. That's in association with a positive PNA, along with a turn to a slightly negative EPO. And an upper-level ridge is going to be parked over the Gulf of Alaska. In other words, the Pacific jet hose is going to be turned off. This kind of upper-level ridging building, these orange colors, are replacing the bluer colors, the lower heights, as we've had a very vigorous west-east Pacific jet stream, that fire hose effect just basically moving right into California, into Northern California, storm after storm after storm, this parade of storms. But this is now showing a break in that pattern where we're going to get ridging there along the coast of Western North America. Bottom line is after 21 January, as we head to late January, we could see below normal temps across the eastern and central U.S. It's too far out in time to determine any storm potentials at this point. Right now, really not seeing much in the way of storm potential that far out. Additionally, we're still closely watching the stratospheric polar vortex for potential elongation or stretching and colder temps across the eastern U.S. in late January. We're really not seeing, you know, I've been watching the polar vortex forecasts very closely. I'm seeing the elongation effect. I didn't really show it in today's presentation, but that's something we still have to factor in as a potential, you know, impact. If it stretches out, it could definitely result in colder temperatures into the eastern U.S., eastern portions of North America coming into late January. All right, that wraps things up on today's video. I hope you enjoyed it. I just wanted to get everybody up to date on what's going on in the latest charts, as well as teleconnections forecast, MJO, and just taking a look at the La Nina, where the sea surface temperature anomalies, what they're looking like here over the left. Kind of went through the different solutions, model solutions for the late week storm. In today's video, talking about both vorticity, the importance of it, as well as the surface charts here, the operational model, where's the rain, where's the snow. In general, it looks like it's going to be a fairly mild system up the eastern seaboard, all the way up to New England, ahead of the strong cold front. Now, could things change in this area of low pressure that Canadian and the European operational are showing could develop and intensify right off the coast here? It's possible. But right now, it just seems like all the moisture is well offshore over the Western Atlantic. The heaviest precip remains over the Western Atlantic and doesn't really get wrapped around the storm, and it doesn't change this rain over to snow. But again, things can happen and things can change. So we'll keep watching it closely. But as of right now, that's the latest from Spot On Weather. We thank you so much for subscribing to our YouTube channel. And until next time, everybody, take care and God bless everyone.